Watch it!
Mr. Harrison, you're rolling.
Oh, shit. What's up, guys? Echo Grande coming at you with the next Game of Thrones review. The heat is on with this one as we get some more bittersweet reunions, action-packed set pieces, and just all around more epic fantasy. We start off with the aftermath of the sack of Highgarden, and Jaime is obviously pissed about Olenna revealing she was Joffrey's murderer. Bronn gives him shit about both his mood and the payment that Jaime promised him. If you recall, Jaime promised him a castle, and Bronn requests control of Highgarden. Jaime deflects as he always does, and instead sends Bronn with Randall Tarly to strong-arm the local farmers. Bronn's starting to look like he picked the wrong side, it seems. Hate to have his former best friend end up killing him. Meanwhile, Cersei and Tycho are discussing Cersei's debt to the Iron Bank. If I recall, Tycho had a full beard way back in season 4. Now he's all clean-shaven, looking like Sting planning a guest concert down in Fleabottom. In Winterfell, Littlefinger is kissing up to Bran. Probably knows he has some newfound abilities now, and as a gesture of trust gives him the dagger that was used as an attempt on Bran's life. Turns out the dagger is made of Valyrian steel, a detail I might have missed watching the whole show, so give me a damn break. Littlefinger continues to kiss Bran's ass until Bran intimidates him by quoting his line to Varys back in season 3.
Chaos is a ladder.
Which may imply Bran knows of all the times that Littlefinger stabbed his family in the back. Littlefinger gets a little spooked and buggers off when Mira shows up to say she's going back to her own people and says goodbye to Bran. Bran seems to have lost his boyish charm when Mira reminds him of all the hardships they've endured and the sacrifices her brother Jojen Reed and Hodor. Made, and Bran still doesn't seem as grateful. Seems like his soul was left in the cavern with the OG three-eyed raven. If I'm right, this could be Bran's final form. Arya arrives at the entrance of Winterfell. As always, she finds it difficult to get what she wants as the soldiers give her grief and refuse her entry. Things get messy when Arya reminds them what could happen if Sansa found out that they turned away her sister. They seem to listen when they end up letting her in and they send for Sansa. But like the cat assassin she is, she disappears. When Sansa gets word of this, she tracks her down in the catacombs. Bit of a bittersweet reunion at first, until Sansa breaks the ice and beelines in for a hug. They don't seem to catch up much, Sansa just tells Arya about Jon's trip to Dragonstone. More awkward small talk when Arya critiques the statue of her father's grave. Until Sansa brings up Joffrey and both find a common ground when they both admit they both wanted to be the one to kill him. All that's missing are a couple glasses of wine and something to watch on SoapNet. Arya reveals her infamous death list to Sansa, but she ends up taking it as a joke. Sansa really doesn't know her sister after all. To think merely 6 years ago, these two were just arguing about sewing supplies. Arya says neither of their stories are over yet, and just like that, congratulations, Arya, you have just sealed yours and your sister's fate before the show ends. Sansa tells Arya about Bran, and they go to him, a shy look of worry on Sansa's face, leaving Arya just as concerned. Arya is obviously excited to see Bran, but Bran continues to look just as indifferent, even after Arya embraces him in a sisterly hug. Sansa reveals Bran's ability to Arya, and Bran in turn reveals that Arya's death list is not a joke. This scene is telling me that Bran just might be at the center of the endgame. If he truly knows everything, there's no way he doesn't know when the White Walkers are gonna come exactly and how to beat them. Bran gives Arya the Valyrian steel dagger that Littlefinger gave him, and that's that. These Stark reunions this season seem a little rushed, but you know what? I can't really blame the writers.
Methinks they have other plans that will take more screen time for the Stark family.
Something tells me Rickon wasn't gonna be the last Stark death on this show. Brienne and Podrick spot the Stark children as they're walking through the courtyard. And as always, Brienne beats herself up for hardly doing anything to get them home. While this is sort of true, Podrick the Pimp takes note of this and continues to call her a lady. Brienne seems to reject the title in her typical Brienne way, but this time doesn't really argue much against Podrick. Perhaps Brienne is starting to accept her identity after all. Bit of a rushed scene for Brienne's development, considering this is her first actual dialogue the entire season. Nah, I still liked it. Moving on. Jon shows Daenerys the caverns where the dragonglass is being kept. Daenerys looks surprisingly shocked at this fact as she looks amongst the dragonglass as if she were looking at her own three children. Jon shows her some cave markings that turn out to be the lore lore of the Children of the Forest. How they existed along with the First Men, fighting their common enemy, the White Walkers, which the Children of the Forest made themselves. This was a pretty touching scene, except those markings looked kinda clean for being over thousands of years old. Like my 8-year-old nephew did them for art class. Jon continues to imperatively state the necessity of his and Daenerys' alliance. Daenerys appears to finally give in, but still sticks to her guns and wants Jon to bend the knee, accepting her as ruler of Westeros. This time, however, she plays the Jon is still king card and says this is best for Jon's people as their leader. Outside, Tyrion and Varys announced to Daenerys the Unsullied's taking of Casterly Rock. But unfortunately, this isn't all good news, as Grey Worm and the Unsullied are still trapped due to Euron's attack on their ships. Daenerys shows her fallibility when she asks Jon, of all people, what she should do. Jon advises her not to stoop to their level by taking her dragons and burning and killing everything. Daenerys thinks hard on this as we cut back to Winterfell, where Brienne trains Podrick while Arya, Littlefinger, and Sansa watch. Arya strolls in her badass little doublet and shows off Needle, which Brienne can only react to as if a mom was reacting to her daughter playing with a little toy. Then commences what I can only call
Arya's crowning moment,
when Arya starts to kick Brienne's ass in the most savage way possible. The cinematography, the music pertaining to the theme that plays during Arya's training with Cyrio Forel. Probably the best one-on-one fight I've seen since Ned Stark versus Jaime Lannister way back in season 1. I could just feel the respect between each character in this scene through my TV screen like a warm blanket. Especially this weird little eye contact between Arya and Littlefinger, who was still eyeballing her sister Sansa. Still eyeballing her with his boner gaze, I might add. Arya and Littlefinger nod at each other as we cut back to Dragonstone, while Dany seems to have disappeared while Davos and Jon stumble upon Missandei. Davos continuing to put the moves on her as they compare the concepts of relationships and marriage in Westeros versus where Missandei is from, Narth. Just then, a loner Greyjoy ship approaches the shore, containing Theon and the remaining survivors from Euron's Greyjoy attack. And then comes another tasteless, bittersweet reunion, as Jon nearly strangles Theon and nearly kills him but keeps him alive because of what he did for Sansa, which I'll remind you was helping Sansa escape Ramsay's clutches while he was in control of Winterfell. Jaime and Bronn are observing the raiding of farms in the Reach. After some more weird humor with Randall Tarly's men, the army feels a strange rumbling over the horizon, as a massive Dothraki horde stomps its way towards the Lannister-Tarly infantry. As if this scene wasn't beautiful enough, Viserion, one of Dany's dragons, soars over the Dothraki with Dany in the saddle. I get chills every time at that appearance. Things only get more sweet as Lannister and Tarly men alike all get cooked, while the Dothraki charge their way over the burnt bodies. Couldn't help but chuckle at Jaime's bewildered gaze as their men die all around them. And it's all topped off with Daenerys' beautiful 2.0 theme. I think this is the first time that I and everyone have seen a terrified Bronn. From the first time he saw the Dothraki, he knew they were fucked. And yet he's just sitting there on his horse next to Jaime, probably thinking to himself,
"Oh, I should have stuck with the little guy."
The irony kicks in when it turns out Tyrion has joined Daenerys on her attack and watches the battle from afar, only having eyes on his brother, and has no idea his former companion is trying to kill Daenerys' dragon. One more thing I'd like to add before we move on is the epic long take of Bronn kicking ass, taking us back to Jon's long take during the Battle of the Bastards. About 2 minutes total of Bronn kicking ass in one take. I counted. Sort of. Bronn gets a lucky hit on Viserion's wing and his fan count drops to 5. Then Tyrion spots Jaime as he charges in to finish Dany off while she's repairing Viserion's wing. But things get crazy real fast when Dany spots her and then Viserion spots him ready to cook him alive. But Bronn to the rescue as he throws both himself and Jaime off their horses and into the abyss of the sea right next to them. Only Jaime can be seen plummeting into the eternal depths, probably due to the heavy armor he's wearing, and we cut to songless credits. My favorite kind of Game of Thrones credits, I might add. Now, I'm not a shallow man. I don't ask much of my fantasy shows or movies. Perhaps just one or two romantic dinners before I get mindfucked. But that was the premier holy shit package. This right here is what Game of Thrones is all about. The Red Wedding, the execution of Ned Stark, the Battle of the Bastards. All these moments where all of our favorite characters are in one location. They probably don't know of each other's presence, but we do, and that's what you call dramatic irony. That's what makes Game of Thrones so awesome. It puts us in the action as these omnipotent viewers, because we know everything that's going on while the characters don't exactly know everything going on. Such poetic and beautiful action set pieces where all of our protagonists square square off against each other in one epic battle after another, with some fantastic acting to boot from our Golden Boy and our favorite,
or used to be favorite,
Sellsword. And then let's not forget Golden Boy, who's shown the first sign of evil since he threatened Edmure Tully to make his uncle give up River Run. I mean, the fire in his eyes when he was charging at Daenerys while she was on the ground. Whilst Tyrion looks on in horror, calling his brother an idiot, which reveals to himself and the audience he still cares about his brother. This was a juicy ending, almost as good as the Red Wedding. And might I add, even if it was shorter, borderline epic with the Battle of the Bastards. Everything else was fantastic about this episode. I had my doubts, but luckily they were extinguished watching episode 4. The Starks are all back together finally, minus a few family members of course, and the alliance between Jon and Daenerys is coming along nicely. Take my words with a grain of salt, I still don't know if they're gonna bang or not. But if they do, could you imagine? That's gonna be a pretty bleak ending for Game of Thrones, cause then we'd be continuing the incestuous cycle that Targaryens have kept up for their entire bloodline. That may not be the case. Plus, we have more pressing matters to attend to. We don't even know if Viserion's gonna make it out alive or not. I mean, they actually wounded one of Dany's dragons. And let's not forget Golden Boy, who's sinking into the ocean. I digress, a lot is yet to be seen. All in all, this was fantastic. It was a short and sweet episode. Nothing felt like it was served to us, and left us with a lot of answers, but even more questions. Which I honestly don't have a problem with, just leaves me wanting more. Which is something this show has rarely done the last couple years. Next week, hopefully we'll get these major cliffhangers resolved, and we'll be taking another big step towards the end game. And I sure as hell will be there to review it all. Thanks as always for watching, and you know what's coming at ya. My name is Matt, and I am getting thrown into the ocean. Bye-bye.